Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Siddharth. I'm senior resident in Department of Ophthalmology at Lady Harding Medical College. I'm presenting my patient who was a 4-year male child who presented to the ophthalmic unit of a tertiary care hospital with the chief complaint of drooping of the right upper eyelid for last 6 months and drooping of the left eyelid for last 1 month. According to the mother, the child was apparently well 6 months back when, after being hit by a cricket bat on the face, developed swelling over right side of the forehead above the eye. There was no history of direct injury to the eye, redness, watering or diminution of vision. After 15 days, mother noticed drooping of the right upper eyelid. Parents consulted a local practitioner in village and was diagnosed as a case of traumatic ptosis. Drooping of the right upper eyelid has been progressively increasing over the last 5 months. The drooping of the left upper eyelid was noticed 1 month back, which is also progressively increasing. There is no definitive history of diurnal variation of drooping of the lids. There is no history of deviation of the eyes, recent immunization, history of spectacle use, or surgical intervention on the eyes. The child at the age of 2 years, based on the ophthalmic photographic records, we can see the child was apparently normal until 5 months back, when we could see that was a apparent ptosis in the right eye. However, the left eye was essentially appearing normal. There was no other history of similar episodes since birth, no history of prolonged fever associated with altered sensorium, or any other systemic illness. The family history was insignificant. Based on the history, we presumed a differential diagnosis of traumatic ptosis, ocular myasthenia gravis, chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, acquired third nerve palsy, or CFEOM. The general physical examination was essentially within normal limits. The systemic examination, including the central nervous system examination, cranial nerves 5, 7 to 12 were normal. The respiratory, cardiovascular system, and abdominal examination were normal. The visual acuity, as far as could be tested, was 6 by 36 at least in both the eyes, and curl vision was normal. Atropine retinoscopy performed revealed a simple myopic astigmatism with the rule. On a torchlight examination, the corneal light reflex could be seen at the nasal limbus in the right eye and the nasal pupillary margin in the left eye. And on covering the left eye, right eye moved inwards towards the midline by 30 degrees. The head posture was maintained with occasional chin up position, and the facial symmetry was, the facies were symmetrical. There was bilateral frontalis overaction. There was severe ptosis in the right eye, and the Corgan's lid twitch sign and ptosis enhancement sign was positive. There was moderate to severe ptosis in the left eye. The elevation, depression, adductions were limited in both the eyes. There was limitation in levo elevation, levoversion, levodepression in the left eye. The medial movements were limited in the right eye in the left case, and similarly, the movements in the left eye were limited in the right case. The child was worked up for ptosis. There was comparable levator action of 4 to 5 millimeters in both the eyes. Bell's phenomena was poor and jaw winking phenomena was negative. Anterior segment examination, including the pupils, was normal. There was a good fundal glow in both the eyes, and the posterior segment evaluation was normal. There was a grade 2 unit, the plus 2 units of intorsion, which was observed in the left eye. So it was a 4-year male child with gradually progressive moderate to severe ptosis bilaterally without any definitive diurnal variation with concomitant strabismus. There was non-specific pattern of limitation of ocular movements. The child was advised acetylcholine receptor binding antibody titers, which was found to be markedly elevated. And the neostigmine stimulation test was performed, and we could see that the child was admitted, and we could see that there was marked improvement in ptosis in both the eyes. However, the ophthalmoplegia persisted and the ocular movements were comparable as was prior to the procedure. The child had additionally subclinical hypothyroidism. The chest X-ray and CT scan were done to rule out thymoma, which was absent. The child was started on 15 milligram pyridostigmine 6 hourly, and he is responsive to treatment. Doses has improved significantly, but ophthalmoplegia is still persistent. So juvenile myasthenia gravis occurs as a result of acetylcholine receptor antibodies and muscle spine specific kinase antibodies, which result in decreased acetylcholine receptor activity, which result in early easy fatigability. In around 20% of juvenile myasthenia gravis patients, symptoms remain limited to extraocular muscles, and almost all patients experience some degree of ocular weakness during the course of their disease. Ptosis is mostly asymmetrical and may be alternating. Nearly 90% of children with juvenile myasthenia gravis have ocular symptoms, and about 50% consult an ophthalmologist first. Acetylcholine receptor antibodies are detected in 50% of patients with ocular myasthenia. It is not a life-threatening but a lifelong disease, and available treatment options are currently to improve vision, are supportive, and to prevent progression to generalized myasthenia gravis. Thank you. It was subclinical hypothyroidism, which was eventually detected after the acetylcholine receptors just to see whether there were other autoimmune conditions associated. So the child had elevated TSH titers, but T3 and T4 were normal.
Yeah, because if he had thyroid disorder, if he had any other diabetes, all those issues, then they are likely to have myasthenia. The other thing is he has large exotropia.
Yes, sir.
Large exodeviation, and he has never complained of diplopia ever. That is.
No, the mother has never complained. The mother did not complain with the deviation of the eye. She only complained with the complaint of ptosis, more so in the right eye, and now since 1 month in the left eye. That was the only complaint with the mother. That was not. That was the unusual part about this case, that it was not.
Once in a while, this test could also be false positive, whatever case we are talking about. So the false negative and false positives can also happen, and can always happen in myasthenia. So it has to be an overall diagnosis rather based on one thing. Of course, ACHRAB, if you are saying they were positive,
yes, sir.
They are a good pointer towards the diagnosis.
Even the new stigmine stimulation test was positive. The child was.
They can be at times false positive, false negative. That is possible, but here the response was reasonably okay. So it does look like a case of
treatment. Yeah.
Response to the treatment.
Yeah, the child is improving. Yes, sir. The child is improving with pyridostigmine that has been started. So we have to see that. First is the ptosis, because the ptosis may. So the visual acuity, we have to check the visual acuity later, because at present it's because of the ptosis and the ophthalmoplegia, it can eventually lead to recalcitrant amblyopia in this child. Also, not necessarily, because he's already. Sir, we have to check for the progression to generalized myasthenia gravis. That is what is the more main treatment indication.
So that electrophoresis, so we can wean out the antibody.
All children, I think that's for older people. Anyway, this is, I think, interesting
case. Yeah, it's a good case.
It's a good case, but how do you explain the strabismus part in this? These are two different entities, or
yes.
So now,
and secondly, since the other eye is also involved, and the both extraocular muscles are being involved,
yes, sir.
Why you could not keep it in progressive myopathies?
So that was one of the differentials, but the response to treatment, everything added to,
did you work up further for the squint part?
For CPU.
What is the cause of squint in this? Or you concentrated only on ptosis and finished?
No, sir, that can be a part of myasthenia gravis as such, because there is non-specific. That is the difference between the pediatric and adult onset
myasthenia. If it is a part of myasthenia, then when you gave the treatment, the squint part should also improve.
So that is what the child has followed up for 3 months only, and only the ptosis is improved.
All the photographs which we saw right from the very beginning,
yes, sir.
The child is having a marked exotropia.
Yes, sir.
And after you gave the treatment also, it is no doubt the ptosis part improved, but the squinting part never had any effect on.
You have not done any post-traction test or muscle post-traction test, you did not do.
That has not been done.
You would have known that is it contracted or is it because of the varices, and what that is likely pointing out that once you give new stigmine or hydroponium, some improvement in ptosis in ocular movement should also happen. In your case, there is no improvement in motility to whatever we can see.
There's no significant improvement, sir, as such.
Though motility is difficult to respond, at times it doesn't respond, it takes much longer to respond, that is true. But when you are giving these therapeutic trials, usually some response should have been there.
So the patient has followed only till 3 months. So after that.
Enough to get the response. It's a good enough time.
Yeah.
Yes,
sir.
Okay. Especially, the test is 3 months instant. Results
are
instant.
Did you go for any imaging of the child? CT scan or MRI? Or
so the patient the patient has only been drugged up for thymoma, not neural imaging.
But this is incomplete.
Thymoma is a small child.
It's unlikely.
No.
So the patient has not followed up. That is the only point. Because the patient has
I mean to
not
say that before.
been admitted in pediatrics where the neostigmine stimulation test was done. And the patient has been started on treatment from pediatricians only.
Okay, just follow it up and see actually what
patient is under Kalavati Hospital.